Imagine a single dose of medicine priced at $3.5 million. Since the approval of the gene therapy Hemgenix in 2022, this is a reality. This eye-popping price is easy to scrutinize, but have you ever wondered how these therapies actually work and if the prices might be fair? Drug manufacturers clearly think so, with some even winding down operations due to pricing disagreements. Also, it couldn't be more fitting that one of the companies we will talk about, who is selling a very simple drug for $1 million a year, very recently saw itself forced to lay off 25% of its staff, maintain loans, and preserve cash to simply stay alive for another year. After this video, you will know why soaring prices do not always equal large profits. You will understand why some therapies, as crazy as it sounds, cannot be sold for prices under hundreds of thousands of dollars. You will also be able to brag to your friends about knowing the top contenders for the world's most expensive drug. You'll learn about the chemical synthesis of a drug used in an ultra-rare disease occurring in 1 out of 40 million people. You already know this one is going to be expensive. And last, you will know why Hemgenix, as mad as it sounds, can actually rationalize its value and price tag. We will also understand how gene therapies work and why this technology will not lead to real-life Resident Evil. Hemgenix approval dethroned the gene therapies Skysona and Zynteglo, both developed as rare disease therapies by the company Bluebird Bio, with costs per dose of 3 and 2.8 million respectively. Maybe shocking to some of you, the Institute for Clinical and Economic Review, ICER, a non-profit organization publishing clinical and cost-effectiveness analyses of treatments, deemed the true value of Zynteglo to be not too far off. The company itself postulated normal standard of care consisting of regular transfusion treatments cumulate to total healthcare costs of over $6 million over a patient's lifetime. Comparing this with Soliris, which had been the world's most expensive drug for some years in the past decade, we can see that in certain diseases such as myasthenia gravis, a cost-effective price would require a more than 95% discount on the annual price. This means million-dollar gene therapies are typically not so bad in terms of value provided. We also have seen some companies offer outcome-based deals where, for example, 80% of the price is refunded if the patient does not respond to therapy. Gene therapies are also less overpriced if we look at the cost that it takes to produce them. Producing the annual supply of the antibody Soliris costs less than 1% of its list price. In contrast, gene therapies require bespoke manufacturing and supply chains, with fully loaded manufacturing costs reaching over $200,000 in some cases. But maybe you're wondering why companies wouldn't sell them at a lower price, let's say $500,000, and still make a decent profit. Well, first of all, these variable costs do not include the large capital investments required for the gene therapy manufacturing facilities. But as anyone who had more than 30 minutes of business school will tell you, there are many more direct and indirect costs behind drugs. Currently, it costs around $2.3 billion to research, develop, and launch a new drug. As you can see, R&D costs have been trending up, roughly doubling during the last decade. Some drugs are even higher than $3.5 billion. These large upfront investments are why a company will typically command as high of a price as it can get, simply to maximize internal return on the dollar. But we can also see that the peak sales potential of drugs decreased in recent years. So basically, development is getting more expensive while the returns are getting smaller and smaller. Don't forget that there are other costs beyond the manufacturing costs we just highlighted. Companies deploy various functional teams to drive the uptake of drugs. The easiest to think about are sales and marketing. On an aggregated company level, selling, general, and administrative costs are usually around 15 to 30% of net revenues. On a product level, this obviously depends on the life cycle stage, with new drugs having much more investments behind them than established products, which are more like cash cows. Another important thing to note are gross-to-net price discounts. You see, the list price you read in the news refers to a theoretical price which is actually never paid. In the extremely convoluted US healthcare system, manufacturers give discounts to various stakeholders involved in access, distribution, or other things. These intransparent gross-to-net discounts translate into actual net sales for companies which can be less than 50% of the original list price. Last, one of the underlying problems behind high development costs is the low probability of clinical success. Science and drug development is inherently high risk, high reward. While big companies with more than 100 projects will always get something out of their R&D funnel just due to statistics, smaller companies can get wiped out if several drugs turn out to simply not work as hoped. This is why no company will ever price drugs at minimal margins, because prices need to be high to compensate for large R&D costs and offer protection against critical pipeline setbacks. Now that we've seen some ridiculous prices but also have started to feel slightly bad for the risk-exposed pharmaceutical companies, let's throw in some organic chemistry and talk about the small molecule lonafarnib. This drug was originally discovered by Shering Plow more than 2 decades ago as an investigational cancer drug. After development for oncology was discontinued due to lack of efficacy and Shering Plow was acquired by Merck, a deal was struck with the small biotech Eiger Pharmaceuticals. Eiger originally wanted to develop the molecule for hepatitis D, but was also introduced to the Progeria Research Foundation by Merck. This non-profit research organization found that the mechanism underlying lonafarnib's activity in cancer was also involved in progeria. This is a heartbreaking disorder causing rapid aging in children. With a prevalence rate of 1 case in 20 to 40 million individuals, this is an ultra-rare disease. Patients die at an average age of 13 years, perversely from cardiovascular failure, heart attack or stroke, so the unmet need is massive. This always fatal disease is caused by mutations in the gene coding for a protein called lamin A. A single cytosine to thymine misspelling is the most common mutation and has critical effects. You see, normal lamin A is modified with a farnesyl group which helps direct it to the nuclear lamina. Basically, it's a shipping tag. The tag is subsequently cut off from normal lamin A. However, the mutated progerin cannot undergo this step, meaning the unnatural shipping tag stays on the protein, and this interferes with a myriad of different cellular mechanisms. Because lonafarnib is a farnesyl transferase inhibitor, it prevents the addition of farnesyl groups to progerin to start with. Due to the missing shipping tag, the proteins do not reach their destination as effectively, but also they do not accumulate and mess things up either. Although far from a cure, the simple farnesylation block has significant clinical impact. Treated patients have significantly lower mortality risk and over the course of 11 years live roughly 2.5 years longer. The molecule also had a good safety profile with a small number of discontinuations. As this is a significant improvement in a ridiculously small patient population, we can start to understand why this medicine costs around 1 million a year, despite being a simple small molecule. There are only few sales to be made, as many of the 400 children living with progeria worldwide were already dosed in your clinical trials or inaccessible. Of course, Eiger could theoretically sell it for cheaper, but you must also consider costs of the several clinical trials which lonafarnib was tested in, including its oncology history. So even though the price looks Machiavellian, the company actually lost $200 million in the last 3 years. The current R&D spend is focused on the development in hepatitis D, which is a much bigger commercial opportunity, but will also come with lower pricing. They also have additional pipeline projects, so all of this cash drain resulted in them recently communicating a 25% workforce reduction. In summary, we see that having the most expensive small molecule drug doesn't necessarily make life easy. What do you think about this? Let me know in the comments. To my own surprise, even in 2023 there is new research looking at lonafarnib analogs which might resurrect development of farnesyl transferase inhibitors in oncology. You can take a look if you're interested yourself, because we will now shift to the chemical essence of this story. Let's check out lonafarnib's synthetic route, which was performed on a up to mind-blowing 100 kilogram scale when it had been first envisioned as a broad oncology drug. If you compare this intermediate to our target structure, you will notice that we need to introduce an aryl bromide group. How can we do this selectively? If you ever had some electrophilic aromatic substitution theory, you would know that this is basically impossible without taking some detours and blocking other carbons that are more electronically activated due to the present chloride substituent. The process team achieved this blockage by a single nitration, giving rise to two nitroregioisomers. You will realize that regardless of their position, the effect is the same. They established an, at the time, novel reduction system with catalytic iodide which can reduce the nitro group as well as the ketone, saving one step. A mix of hypophosphorus and phosphorus acid avoided halogen side reactions while reducing both groups. However, they also observed severe foaming at the beginning of the reaction. Quite understandably, they didn't want their 100 kg reaction to start foaming violently, so they performed a more controlled stepwise method, first adding H3PO3 to reduce the nitro group and then H3PO2 to reduce the ketone. This system proved much better than hydrogenation or metal catalysis, which would have decomposed the aryl halide groups and introduced potential contaminants. With the amine in place, the desired bromination product is favored through either ortho direction in one of the isomers or para direction in the other. That's why the regioisomers don't matter. After removal of the amino groups, the most acidic site is between the aryl rings. The addition of LDA, quinine, and this electrophile led to a chiral alkylation proceeding with an impressive 95% EE. Can you write the mechanism? It might seem like the carbanion attacks the mesylate, but think about why the reaction is enantioselective. Gratifyingly, they were able to recycle the quinine. Quite important if you run things on a double-digit kilo scale. After this step, it's basically done. First, a diastereomer salt formation allows further enrichment to 99% EE, and then the final part was introduced through an amide formation. Last, a one-pot Bock deprotection and urea formation gave the final product. Now that the chemists are happy and satisfied, we can pivot to the most expensive drug. For this, we need to understand a disease called hemophilia B, an inherited bleeding disorder caused by a deficiency of the coagulation factor 9. This disorder is characterized by frequent and recurrent bleeding into joints or soft tissues, leading to chronic pain, disability, and impaired quality of life. The current standard of care for hemophilia B includes lifelong, on-demand and prophylactic replacement therapy with factor 9 concentrates. This replacement therapy is effective at reducing bleeding episodes and is generally well tolerated, although some patients develop antibodies making them resistant to replacement therapy. These repeated injections become extremely expensive over a patient's lifetime, with most estimates well beyond $10 million. ICER says $3 million would be a very reasonable price, so Hemgenix is not too far off. Clearly, this one-time treatment has a lot of impact, but how does it work biochemically? Gene therapies use engineered viruses as carriers or so-called vectors of genetic information to correct a patient's genetic code, ultimately restoring the proper functions of vital proteins. For Hemgenix and most available gene therapies, this vector is adeno-associated virus or AAV-based. It's like a train or truck delivering cargo. As viruses are simply doing virus things, they can enter cells and integrate or transduct the missing gene into the cell's DNA. Compared to normal viruses, these AAV are modified to lose their replicative abilities, rendering them safe as therapies for humans. In addition, a DNA regulatory element called promoter limits the transgene expression in only the desired tissue. In this case, it's the liver, as factor 9 is produced in hepatocytes and is released into circulation from there. The actual factor 9 gene being incorporated is basically a factor 9 protein on steroids, which is 7 times more active than a wild type due to one single mutation. This allows for a lower AAV vector dose, which in turn decreases adverse immune reactions by patients. As you might expect, Hemgenix was found to be superior to replacement therapy in a mid-sized trial with 54 patients, leading to a significantly lower rate of bleeding events as the primary endpoint. 96% of patients were able to stop replacement therapy. This transformational benefit can also be seen in the increased factor 9 activity of patients. Severe hemophilia B is characterized with untreated factor 9 activity below 5%. Here we can observe an immediate and sustained increase post-treatment. Hemgenix was only studied in adults, so it's approved for patients over 18 years. In summary, instead of continuously replacing factor 9 exogenously multiple times a week, incorporation of the missing gene solves the problem for good, or at least for more than 20 years. Now let's do something that most of you have never thought about. What is the actual sales potential of Hemgenix? Will its high price also lead to exorbitant revenues and profits? If you're up for the challenge, you can also pause the video and play around with the numbers yourself. What's that? Do these simple calculations look like a daunting task? or have you confidently calculated this in your head already, instead wishing to enhance your understanding of advanced mathematics or physics to prepare for your next exam? Maybe you're still grappling with a chemistry concept from one of my videos. Whatever your situation, you can get started for free on brilliant.org as the perfect interactive learning resource that can help you. Don't dismiss it just yet, assuming it's only for math nerds and not for natural science enthusiasts. While Brilliant does offer thousands of lessons to get you from basic to advanced in math, computer science, and data science, they also provide in-depth courses on chemistry, physics, and biology. Beyond clear explanations and nice visuals, there are various quizzes and problems to challenge your understanding and critical thinking skills. Think you're a chemistry whiz? Try this question. I bet most of you won't get it right. Check the pinned comment below for the answer. If you're wrong, you should definitely check out the chemistry course. Try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for 30 days and get 20% off the annual premium subscription by visiting brilliant.org/totalsynthesis. Even if you can't perform Fourier transformations in your head, you might know that total yearly sales are simply the number of sales per year multiplied with the cost per sale. We already know the latter. But what is the true number of patients that could get treated? Well, there's only approximately 6,000 people with hemophilia B in the US. Let's assume this population grows by 1% each year. Do you remember if we can treat all of them? No. Hemgenix is only approved for adult patients, which might be around 80% of them. And only in cases with severe hemophilia B, maybe around 60% of patients. So 6,000 times 80% times 60%, some of you might do it in your head, is 2,880. But why is the number I have here different? Well, I mentioned some patients develop antibodies or inhibitors to factor 9 replacement therapy, and because Hemgenix is not tested in these patients, they should be excluded as well. This reduces our eligible pool by 2%. If you think this number is our quantity to be multiplied with the price, think again. Will all of the patients be treated with Hemgenix and will this happen immediately? Clearly not. Most of them will never receive the therapy given the limited coverage due to the high cost. And the uptake will only increase gradually with time. It's probably fair to say that not much more than 10% of patients will ever get Hemgenix, and we also need to assume a build over time, let's say a 1-2 percentage point every year. Hemgenix is a one-time treatment, so patients are either practically cured or don't respond and can't try a second time. Therefore, the more patients are treated, the lower the addressable pool. But hey, this therapy will not be the only one. There's another hemophilia B gene therapy being developed by Pfizer and Spark. Even if we assume that the first to market therapy will dominate, the second product will also have some penetration. Obviously, this all depends on the differentiation, so its relative efficacy, safety, and importantly, price. Here I simply assumed that the new product would have 50% of Hemgenix uptake delayed by 1 year. This means the blue line gives us the actual pool we can treat with each product in every year, factoring in the total number of patients previously treated with Hemgenix and the Pfizer Spark product. I hope you could follow so far. Now we take the number of new patients treated with Hemgenix, calculated by multiplying the phased penetration with the untreated addressable pool, and finally multiplied with the price per patient. There are also some less important pricing assumptions that can be made here. Do you notice anything about the result? You're spot on. The number of Hemgenix treated patients actually peaks after just a few years. Maybe even staying below 200 patients per year. This translates into peak net sales of around 630 million. Definitely nothing to sneeze at, but we also have to be real here. Many mega blockbusters with lower pricing are much more lucrative for companies due to steady revenues and higher number of patients. If we throw in the $250,000 per unit gene therapy production cost, the program development cost, and all of our functional and selling general and administrative costs on top of this, we are left with a quite modest profit that is not as high as you might expect. And let's once again reiterate the topic of low probability of success. If you have bad luck, you will spend the profits from one drug all in vain to finance the development of another unsuccessful one. Even the simplest medicines can simply fail to demonstrate efficacy, but the development of innovative therapies like gene or cell therapies is another beast. Very recently, the FDA put a clinical hold on Arcellx phase 2 investigating a CAR T cell therapy following the death of a patient. Just half a year prior, Gilead invested over $300 million to secure development and commercialization rights. This shows you how fast the profits gained on some products can potentially disappear. Thank you for sticking through to the end of the video. I hope you learned something new today. Please leave a comment and a like if you enjoyed this video and let me know if you have any suggestions for future ones. Also, consider becoming a YouTube member or Patreon to support the channel. Thanks again and until next time.